Thank you very much. It has been 25 years since I have been in Athens last time, and I think it's long overdue. So thank you very much for giving me this opportunity to come here and to present and to speak to you about the history of manufacturing and a little bit of an outlook in the future. My name is Chris Roser, and I'm an engineer, a German engineer. And I've spent quite a lot of time all over the world. I did my undergrad, I did my PhD in America. I spent 5 years with Toyota in Japan. I worked for McKinsey, for Bosch, and now since 5 years, I'm a professor in Karlsruhe. And my specialty is lean manufacturing, how to improve manufacturing. I also write a blog all about lean, where I try to explain lean concepts, manufacturing concepts in simple words, and I try to help companies which may not be able to afford a consultant. But my hobby is history, technical history, and as mentioned before, I wrote a book, Faster, Better, Cheaper, on the history of manufacturing, and I would like to talk to you today about this interesting history and especially how people work. Not so much the technical side, but how do people work? So, let's go back quite a bit in the history and let's start at the very, very beginning. 2.5 million years ago was when humankind started and also when manufacturing started. It was a time of Homo habilis, the first member of the genus Homo, to which we Homo sapiens also belong. And habilis is Latin for working with hands, for crafting. It was the first ape or human, whichever way you want to see it, which made tools. And they made very simple tools, but they made tools. Already back then, we have indication of division of labor, that different people had different specialties. For example, there was one location, one factory, you could call it, where they made stone tools for about 1 million years. So probably the longest running factory in the world. And they had one location where they made new stone tools. A little bit away from it, they had a second location where the chips and the archaeologists found that they made, that they refurbished old tools and made them new again. And the stones came from two mountains 10 kilometers away in one and the other direction. So it could be one person which walks through the mountain, gets the stones and brings it back and uses one side for new tools and one side for old tools. But more likely was it that there was one specialist for making new stone tools and one specialist for refurbishing old stone tools to make them usable again. And since there were probably some people who had no skills except carrying stones through the landscape. So already division of labor back then at the beginning of humanity. Now, let's go a big step towards the future and a much bigger step close to here. Let's go to Athens. The philosopher Xenophon of Athens gives us the first written indication of division of labor. And he wrote that in a small city, the same person builds beds, chairs, plows, tables, and houses, and kind of one person had to do everything. But in bigger cities, there was already a very refined specialization, a very refined division of labor, with one person stitching shoes, another cutting them, the third one shaping the leather, and another one putting everything together. So already, division of labor, very, very early in human history. And of course, division of labor makes us more efficient. If you have to do everything, you can't be really good at all of them. But if you focus on one aspect of manufacturing, you can really get good at it. You can optimize, you can go to perfection and become really efficient, good, and faster, better, and cheaper than somebody who has to do it all. So, big improvement for manufacturing. Another thing that changed, we humans are pretty weak with regards to our strengths. Any animal of equal weight can easily overpower us. Even animals of half our size may still be able to overpower us because we are weak. We do have lots of dexterity. We can move our fingers very, very coordinated, but we are weak. So one thing we did very early on too was to use additional power sources. We have here a Roman-powered flour mill, a horse-powered flour mill from the Roman era. We have a Persian windmill, and we have a Chinese water mill. If you look closer at the windmill and the water mill, it doesn't quite look like a Holland windmill, because they did not yet know how to make gears. The same shaft which was rotating with the wind, the same shaft also rotated the stone to grind the flour. Same here, the same shaft that was powered by water also ground the flours up here. Only with the invention of gears were we able to have a shaft rotating in one direction, transferred into a shaft rotating into another direction. And again, it was an invention by the Greek. The Romans also managed to get it into a back and forth motion to make this sawmill to transfer a rotating shaft into a back and forth motion. And with this kind of technology, we could produce much more because now we are no longer limited by our own strengths. So power sources, big step forward in production. Also tools, we have the Egyptian potter wheel, we have an Egyptian lathe as very early manufacturing machines, very simple machines, to help us produce. So manufacturing improved, but it did so only slowly. Manufacturing had an image problem. Let's refer to the best orator of Roman history, to Cicero. And Cicero said, "All mechanics are engaged in vulgar trades, for no workshop can have anything liberal about it." For Cicero, manufacturing was degrading. Manufacturing was bad. Manufacturing was absolutely not desirable. And that was the opinion in the Roman Empire, that was a very similar opinion in the Chinese Empire, that manufacturing is nothing really you want to do. If you were a high potential of Roman times, you would go into farming or politics or military. But manufacturing, that's for the slaves. That's dirty work, that's unpleasant work. Better leave it to the slaves and don't do much about it. So there was no focus on manufacturing, and because of that, the brightest minds, which could have improved a lot more, went somewhere else. The Romans had great improvements in farming. The Romans managed to get animals to a size which we reached only again in modern times. But manufacturing, it was not good. So it was an image problem. This changed only quite some time later. In Europe. And of course, Europe was very strongly influenced by the Romans, and many places in Europe took Roman concepts, Roman culture, and in many places, manufacturing was unpleasant. But I have here a map of pretty much Germany of 1400. And each of those little dots you see here is its own country. Each of those little dots has its own rules, its own taxes, its own laws, and developed a little bit differently. It was a large number of microstates, often only a single city, which developed in their own way. And some of them disliked manufacturing like the old Romans did. But others slowly changed their minds. Others, manufacturing grew, manufacturing became wealthier, and with wealth, they could also donate to the church. The church also changed their mind and thought, well, if they're giving me money, they can't be that bad, really. And lots of those little places developed differently. And if they developed in manufacturing, they became wealthier, they became more powerful, and assimilated one way or another other places. So starting from those little individual cells, Germany and Europe became strong in manufacturing. And manufacturing rose in prestige. Suddenly, you could be proud of being somebody who makes stuff. You could be proud of manufacturing. Before, in Roman times, you were not invited to parties if you were a craftsman. Also on the marriage market, the women rather went somewhere else than to marry somebody who makes stuff with hands. No. But in Roman times, not only were you invited to the parties, you threw the parties and everybody came. On the marriage market, suddenly you looked a lot more attractive to the women because you did a respectable craft, manufacturing, you made some money, and it became more influential. So a big change in mindset towards manufacturing, that manufacturing is something. Now you could be proud of making stuff. Next comes the Industrial Revolution. You surely have heard of this, but you may not have heard about how it started with a big story of industrial espionage. The main product to make was clothing. And in Italy, in the Piedmont region here, they have developed a machine which could automatically spin silk out of little silk fibers to make a thread of silk. And a British guy, John Lombe, wanted to learn about this technology. He wanted to build his own spinning mill. So he did industrial espionage. He learned Italian. He went to Italy. He bribed a priest to get a job in a factory. He bribed the foreman to stay there after hours. And during the day he worked, during night he made drawings of the machines and sent it back to England. It was a risky business because Italy wanted to protect its intellectual property. And back then, they were not really that gentle. If you were caught, you were dead. A death penalty on export of intellectual property. They found out about John Lombe, but he just barely made it onto a British ship, and the British merchant ship just barely made it away from the chasing Italian Navy ships. So Lombe and his technology safely arrived in Britain. Also, he could have had it much easier because an Italian guy wrote a whole book about this thing, and it was already in the Oxford Library, including drawings and everything, how to make those machines. So, the value of books. So John Lombe built a silk mill, and the Italians were furious. They didn't like the idea, and it happened to be that John Lombe met a beautiful Italian woman. But shortly thereafter, very young, very suddenly, he became very sick and died. And the reaction was very clear, burn the witch! Luckily for the lady, England had a functioning legal system and the court could not prove the guilt, so the lady was innocent and went straight back to Italy, away from this crazy country. But now we had technology in Italy with the silk mill. And back then, like nowadays, silk is more of a luxury product. The better product is cotton. Shorter fibers, a little bit more difficult. But Richard Arkwright managed to do the same spinning machines with cotton and became the richest man in England and also a knight. So it's Sir Richard Arkwright. the whole area where he worked suddenly had lots of spinning mills all over the place. It was the Derwent Valley where there are still dozens of old buildings which were former spinning mills. And now, of course, other countries were interested. Samuel Slater was a British engineer in a spinning mill, and he emigrated to America. Of course, like the Italians, the British said, no, it's our technology. If you export it, death penalty. So he took a false name, went to America, and in America, he is known as the father of the American Industrial Revolution. In Britain, he's known as Slater the Trader. So, depending on your point of view, we may like him or not. The Germans were also interested in this technology. Johann Gottfried Brüggemann wanted to build a German spinning mill. So, he did what the British did. He learned English. He went to the spinning mill of Arkwright. He bribed somebody to work there. He took some notes. He brought the notes back to Germany. You surely have heard this story before, like 5 minutes ago. So he stole the technology from Arkwright, which the British didn't like because now it was their technology, of course, not Italian ones. Only difference, Mr. Brüggemann gave credit where credit is due. So in Germany, there's now a Cromford spinning mill named after the model where he copied it from. But that's how the technology spread through the world. And even nowadays, when we complain about the Chinese copying our technology, if we would be Chinese, it would be a hero. If we would are European, it's a traitor. So, yeah. Another technology was the steam engine, where we could do even more power. And we could have power anywhere. We are no longer dependent on a river where water flows or not. We are no longer dependent on wind power, where the wind may sometimes not blow. And we are no longer dependent on animal power, which needs lots of feeding to support the animal. There are lots of people involved in the making of the steam engine, but probably the most famous one is James Watt. He did not invent the first steam engine, but he made a technical improvement which made it very efficient to use a steam engine. James Watt was a tinkerer. He liked to twiddle. He liked to spend 2 weeks to figure out how to use an even better seal for a piston, and he liked to dig really deep into problems. But he was not a social guy. His company, often he fired key employees on the spot just because he didn't like them or was in a bad mood. Luckily, he had a partner, Mr. Bolton, which was maybe not so good technically, but he had a social skill. He could sell. And whenever James Watt fired a guy just because, he caught him at the door and told him, well, stay out of his sights for 2 weeks. By then he has forgotten it, but you're not fired. And the third one in the list, John Wilkinson, is also known as the Iron Mad Wilkinson, because he developed a new technology to make pistons and cylinders with much higher precision. The people were amazed with the piston and the cylinder. They were so precise, you couldn't fit a coin in the gap anymore. Nowadays, if you have a car engine and you can fit a coin in the gap between the piston and the cylinder, something is very, very wrong. But back then, there was a major achievement to have a precision of only a few millimeters. So that was a big effect, and it had huge synergy effects. For steam engine, you need lots of iron. For iron, you need coal and iron mines and smeltering. Then suddenly there were railways, and it started to build like an avalanche with technology. But it also had its problems. Not everybody was happy with it. Let's take the weavers. Weaver, manufacturing craft. Around 1790, a weaver was stable middle class. He was not rich, but he was not poor. He could afford his life. He could afford a wife. and he was settled and accepted in society. But then came the mechanical looms, steam-powered, water-powered mechanical looms, which were much faster, better, and cheaper than the weaver by hand. So within only 10 or 20 years, the weaver dropped down socially. His income was reduced by half. The expenses, inflation, doubled the prices. So suddenly, he was no longer respected middle class. He was poor. And the women didn't like him either. So what do people do when they're upset? They revolt. So they marched through the land, they burned down factories, they killed a few factory owners and demanded that weavers get a fair salary, and so stamped machines shall be banned. So it was a revolution in Britain. The British king was quite liberal, but his French colleague, only a few years earlier, also had a revolution, the French Revolution. And you know what happened to the French king with the French Revolution? The British king was not that liberal, and the British government put in a lot of energy and a lot of forces against those weavers, against those so-called Luddites. Only probably 100 or 200 people, but the government had a force of 40,000 people, soldiers and policemen, to chase those 100 rebels. For comparison, 40,000 people, that's an army which they also could have used to attack Belgium. So it was a major military engagement for the time. The Luddites eventually gave up. They did not achieve any of their goals. And nowadays, there are almost no hand weavers anymore, which is good. Because with the clothes you wear, or that one here, that shirt is machine spun, machine woven, machine sawn. And it's not something expensive, it's 50 euros on the internet, so typical mass manufactured product. If I would try to get a similar shirt, hand spun, hand woven, hand sawn, it would not be 50 euros, it would be around 5,000 euros. And in this case, I still would have a lot of space in my wardrobe, believe me. So it was good that they didn't put their weight through, but for them, it was a social catastrophe. For them, it was really, really bad. But for us, it's lucky. A little bit further in the future, let's go to the cars. And the most famous guy in car manufacturing is Henry Ford. He is very famous for his assembly line. He did not invent the assembly lines. There were many other assembly lines before, but he made the most efficient use out of the assembly line. He made the most productivity out of this assembly line. The first assembly line was probably this one here. It's an assembly for the generator which powers the battery. And probably 1913 or so. And he had many other assembly lines afterwards, and through that, he was able to significantly reduce the price of his cars. I've calculated inflation-adjusted values. In 1908, when he sold the first Model T, his famous Tin Lizzy, it would have been the modern equivalent of 20,000 euros to buy a car. In 1925, he managed to get the same price to get the price for the same car down to 3,500 euros. And for that price, pretty much everybody could afford a new car. That was the goal of Ford. All of his employees should be able to afford one of his cars. And with that price, he could do it. So he greatly improved manufacturing. He went very much into efficiency to make cars faster, better, cheaper. But he also had his flaws. Henry Ford was in love with his Model T. And to him, it was a perfect car. And if it would be according to Henry Ford, you could go to the Ford dealership right now and buy a brand new Ford Model T. Because a Model T is a perfect car, you never need anything else. That was his point of view. So this Model T is first sold in 1908 up to 1927, so about 20 years, the same car, the same technology, in a rapidly changing world. So if you would have bought a Model T in 1927, it's the equivalent of buying a mobile phone with the technology from 20 years ago. It wouldn't interest you. Same here. Even so, Henry Ford thought it's a perfect car, the customers started to disagree. But Henry Ford decided, no, it's a perfect car, we want to produce it. I know better than the customer what they want, it will be perfect for everybody for the rest of the ages. At one point, his engineers tried to surprise him. They made a prototype for a new car and invited Ford and showed him the new prototype. And Ford got really, really angry, took a big hammer and smashed the whole thing to bits and pieces. Because the Model T is perfect, you never need anything else. Eventually, nobody was buying Model Ts anymore, and eventually Henry Ford also realized, I need a new car. So he did the Model A, starting in 1928, which was a major effort to make this car, because for 20 years, his factory was optimized to the max for producing Model Ts cheaply. For the new car, he figured out, I have to throw out half of my tools. I have to buy tons of new machines. And before I do that, I first have to produce 5 months more of Model Ts because I have so much material in the pipeline. I have parts for 5 months more of Model Ts which I just can't throw out. But eventually, he could start changing the factories, and it took him only 5 months of no production until he could make the first Model A. If you're in manufacturing, imagine having a new product, and in between 5 months of no production while you adjust the factory and set up the new lines. So then Model A should be the car for eternity, but the public again disagreed, and only 3 years later, he had to come out with a Model B. So, very great assembly line, but absolutely no flexibility. The competition did it much better. General Motors, under the leadership of Alfred Sloan, brought out a new car every year. Not only brought out a new car, they celebrated the new car. They advertised new model. New technology, new SIS, new set. You may see this if you look into the newspapers every now and then. That's nowadays still very popular to advertise new things. So every year, a new car. And the public loved it. Of course, it was not always fundamentally re-engineered, but always some twists and tweaks and a little bit new changes. And he was much more successful with this new line of cars, where every year, something new, something fresh, and the public loved it. A little bit later, there was also a back then unknown company called Toyota, which at the beginning also did what most countries do if they don't have the technology. They stole from others. The first Toyota had an engine from Chrysler, had a front axle from Ford, a rear axle, I think, also from a Chrysler model, and just liberally adapted the technology to make their own car. But they also got better over time, and Toyota is nowadays, for many companies, a role model in manufacturing because of their lean manufacturing. And I have to say, I'm a little bit biased because I worked 5 years for Toyota in Japan, and I really like this lean manufacturing. They developed a lot of methods, and I don't want to go through all of them. It's basically a bunch of Japanese words from Andon, Chaku Chaku, Gemba, Genchi, Genbutsu, Heichunku, Chidoka, and so on and so on. If you're interested in that, read my blog, I have more about this, but they developed a lot of new and often simple but cool methods on how to arrange production, on how to make production faster, better, and cheaper. And with lots of inspiration from others, of course, they copied lots from Ford, but also during World War II in America, there was a program, TWI, Training Within Industries. During World War II, also American male manufacturing men were over in Germany fighting us, my country. And there was nobody left in America who knew how to weld and how to drill and mill and manufacture. So they had to take women. Now, very quickly, they had to train women the skill of welding and milling and other stuff, which normally takes a few years, but they needed it quickly, so they made a very successful and good program, Training Within Industry, for how to quickly train people, how to deal with people. Very successful, very good program. The language is a little bit outdated, but if you're into that, it's still very good ideas. Also, some American consultants, Edward Demings, came to there, and also Japanese spirit of making things. The Japanese always paid great attention to detail in manufacturing. All of this came together to make the Toyota production system, which is, in the rest of the world, known as lean production, and which I'm a big fan of, as I said before. Computers and robotics. Another technology that changed and shaped manufacturing. Let's start with NC machines, numerical control. It's basically a machine controlled by a computer. And it started out with the production of helicopters. This helicopter had wooden rotors, and the problem was that they occasionally break and people died. So one guy, John Parsons, was thinking about making saws from metal, but you need lots of such shapes, and every shape is a little bit different. It's a cross-section of the blade of the rotor. And it's easy to calculate by computer, but he did not yet have the technology to make it based on the computer data. So what he did, two people, one with a list of points and the other one with a drill, and the guy said, okay, 317 millimeters right, 27 millimeters up, drill a hole. 319 millimeters right, 20 millimeters up, drill a hole. And so with hole, they made the shape. Obviously, it was a bit of a boring work to do this with 200 holes for one shape and the whole thing for about 30 shapes. So lots of holes being drilled. And quickly they realized, maybe we can do it better with a machine that's directly controlled by the computer rather than having a human in between which just drills holes wherever the computer tells them to. They developed that. Technology was not yet quite ready. The motors to hold a position were not yet good enough. But here too, they got inspiration from the military, which had for their guns, for their ship-based artillery, had motors which hold it up in a very precise position, and they used that technology. They also took help from academia and partnered up with some professors from MIT, Massachusetts Institute of Technology, which liked the idea quite a lot, but they didn't like that it was invented by Parsons rather than by them. So they tried very much to squeeze Parsons out of the business, and for example, Parsons was asking the professors, well, should I write a patent about this? And the professor said, nah, don't bother. It's a little thing, don't bother writing a patent. While the students of the professors were furiously writing a patent to be the first one to apply. Luckily, Parsons applied first, but the MIT really, really very hard tried to push him out of business. But eventually, Parsons was accepted, and it took him 30 years, but now he's seen as the father of this NC technology. Another technology was robotics, and here we see one of the first robots, and It looks very different than what you're used to. It's a robot which can move an arm up, down, in, out, and rotate. But this guy, George Devol, had it much easier. His robot was a success, financial success. He got wealthy with it. He was acknowledged as an inventor. So that one went very well. So, lots of history of manufacturing. What does this mean for the future? A couple of things will come. A couple of things will stay the same. And I believe speed and flexibility will become even more important. Like Henry Ford versus General Motors. Henry Ford, always the same product, and General Motors with a new product every year. Customers loved the new products much, much more. And this will increase even more. If your mobile phone is a little bit earlier to the markets and the competition, it's much better for your bottom line. And this flexibility in manufacturing is hard to achieve, but important. But even more important and even more difficult is the flexibility in the supply chain to deliver these different parts. So I believe in the future, the supply chain, the logistics, will become much, much more important than it is now. I believe it's a big change. What will stay important is attention to detail. And that's where I see sometimes companies lacking. It's easy to make a strategy. It's easy to think, oh, we should do this, or that's our vision, there we want to go. But it's much, much more difficult to actually implement the strategy, to actually get it going, to actually make it, turn it into reality. Because for implementation, you have lots and lots of tiny little details which needs manpower, which needs time, which needs energy to solve those little details. And I have sometimes the feeling that in many companies, they believe strategy execution to make the strategy is an important part, and since they neglect the creation of the strategy. So, definitely something which I think remains important to really tinker with your products, to really go down into detail and go to the shop floor, see the reality, and improve problems there. High-level vision is often not found in the shop floor at the bottom line. We will also have new technologies, and there are a couple of them. That's probably the three most important ones in my point of view. One is artificial intelligence, that computers become more and more smart, with the risk that eventually they may outsmart us. I'm sure you know Moore's law, that the power of computer doubles roughly every 2 years. Luckily, the problem of understanding the world is not quite linear, but with a doubling of computer power every 2 years, it's quite possible that at one point in the coming decades, a computer will have equal capabilities like a human brain. And 2 years later, it will be twice as good. So that's something to look out for. Whenever there are new technologies, there are people which are worried about new technologies, which fear those technologies. When bicycles were introduced, doctors were worried about women riding bicycles that would bring demons. When trains were introduced, people were worried this astonishing speed of 20 kilometers per hour, people will no longer be able to breathe at this speed because it's so fast, and pregnant women will lose their babies at 20 kilometers per hour. So there are always people who worry about new technology. So of course, people also worry about artificial intelligence. What worries me a little bit is that some of those people worrying are not really hostile to technology. For example, famous people like Bill Gates or Elon Musk worry that artificial intelligence has the power to erase humankind at one point in the future. And you can't really blame Bill Gates or Elon Musk for being hostile against technology. So that's something to worry about. A little bit closer will be self-driving cars and batteries. That will also change manufacturing. A normal combustion engine car has about 2,000 or 3,000 moving parts, meaning 2,000 or 3,000 parts which need high precision, which have wear and tear and friction, and that's what makes cars expensive. An electric car will have around 20 moving parts. With an electric car, it's quite possible that you get a lifetime guarantee, or 25 years guarantee on maintenance, because it's so much easier to build. Combined with self-driving, it will massively disrupt automotive industry, which is, in many countries, especially in Germany, one of the main industries. I made an over-the-sum estimation. Currently, we produce about 100 million cars per year. With self-driving cars, taxi will be cheaper than owning a car, and a taxi will be used much better, so it's possible that we need only 50 million cars per year. Production goes back to half, which means we do not need half of the car plants. We do not need half of the workers. We probably don't need much on insurance. And the companies selling cars are no longer selling to individual consumers, which have to take the price the company dictates, but they will be selling to companies like Uber or taxi companies. And if you buy 20,000 cars, they will tell the price to the company, not the other way around. So it will be a big disruption with self-driving cars and batteries. Another technology, which is currently still very early on, but I believe it has great potential and also some risks, is gene technology. Right now, we're just wetting our feet, doing a little bit, making chickens bigger, making corn more productive, making tomatoes last longer in the supermarket shelf. And you surely have read since a few weeks ago, the first two human babies in China with questionable moral ethics, where they modified two baby girls to make them resistant or more resistant against AIDS. But I believe this technology will also increase. The potential benefit will, for many people, eventually outweigh the risks of that one, but it needs to be managed. This is also a technology which, used incorrectly, can turn dangerous. But so does artificial intelligence, and you're not scared of your mobile phone. Well, maybe some of you are, maybe rightfully so. What Google and Facebook knows about you, yeah, never mind. So, lots of changes ahead, but for the foreseeable future, I also strongly believe we still need people to manufacture. We still need humans to improve, to make, to learn, to invent, to make better products. A computer cannot yet improve itself. It still needs humans. Maybe at one point in the future, when artificial intelligence is good enough, they can do this. But for the foreseeable future, for the near future, we still need humans. We definitely need humans for the factory. Lights out factory, where you kind of can turn off the lights because no human is in there anymore, is still very rare, and humans are important for manufacturing. But that also means we need leadership. We need leaders which not only tell people what to do, but we need leaders, that's a manager, but we need leaders which motivate people to do the right thing. We need leaders to motivate people to think for themselves, to solve problems, to encourage problem solving, to make products faster, better, and cheaper. So I'm glad you're all here, and I hope this presentation was interesting to you. And again, if you're into this history, I've written the book on this topic, and if you're into Lean, I can also recommend my blog. But thank you very much for your attention. It was a pleasure to present for you.